Thank you very much. Indeed, it's a great pleasure to be associated with this August gathering and the international fora, where a lot of issues related to DNA forensics have been discussed. I have joined at the last speaker, Dr. Joseph, and he was talking about Innocence Project and other things. And I am very happy to say that I am also working and in Flex Award. I am working on the same so that Innocence Project in one way or other may also be introduced to Indian climate. So thank you very much once again for giving me this opportunity to present my work. I have worked, as mentioned in my intro, in 2020, I worked on POXO, and particularly I have visualized that how forensic evidence can help to improve the quality of criminal justice system. And I will present in 2-3 slides the data which I get from my dissertation. So my topic is basically to talk about the legal aspect of DNA in criminal justice system, rather in justice system, whether it is criminal or civil in nature. And as I mentioned, this jurisprudence, I think many of you might be aware, but I just, for the purpose of clarity, jurisprudence means, juris means law, and prudence means knowledge. So knowledge of law. So we are going to talk about what law, how law look at the DNA as evidence in the court of law. So briefly, I will touch upon why DNA, what is the purpose of DNA for our justice system, and how innocence can be proved in addition to proving the guilt. Then sampling and chain of custody, the jurisprudential part, which is very relevant aspect in, if I talk about the Indian Constitution, Article 20, Part 3 particularly, right against self-incrimination. Then privacy and consent. These are the twin concepts which are intertwined and have very important relevance with DNA sampling, collection of DNA from any living person. And then something about forensic fraud. In the beginning itself, I must admit that nearly... Science that is called criminalistics. So it is the baseline for scientific investigation. So forensic evidence, whatsoever it may be, it brings scientific temper basically in evidence collection. And the purpose of this whole exercise is to enhance the probity of evidence, and ultimately it leads to towards perfect justice. So perfectness is justice system is the ultimate objective of this whole exercise. If you see, the human identification remains the core work of investigation in general, not only in criminal investigation, but even in civil disputes resolution, human identification is the keyword. How? If you see in murder case, sometime the body of the person may not be identified morphologically because the body may be putrefied. Maybe you may get some body remains, bone or something like that. Then on other side, even for the accused, you have to prove the identity of accused beyond reasonable doubt. So both side in criminal law, the victim as well accused has to be proved that this is the actual human being which we are referring to. In civil side, say for example, paternity disputes. So again, you have to identify the paternity, and not only paternity, but even maternity may be challenged. Like in King Solomon Justice, if you remember, that two women came quarreling in the court of King Solomon, having claim on a child. And he, and he asked to bring a sword to cut the child in pieces, and a lady cried and she was identified as the mother. So here there is no scientific tool, but it was the scientific brain. So basically the purpose of this whole exercise is to bring scientific temper, scientific will, scientific argumentation, so that truth may prevail. And for the purpose of human identification, right from morphological feature to DNA profiling, these are various tools in the forensic domain which helps us to identify. So it is not only DNA, many times it may be bundle of evidence which may help somewhere. The foot fingerprint may be helpful. Even from the fingerprint or footprint, you may even extract DNA. So the one has to understand that it is not only one science or one particular area or discipline, but we have to see things in entirety. This you very well know, Locard exchange principle, that when two things comes into contact, so it give you where from you can collect the forensic evidence. Yes, this basically I want to flag you why all these evidence, that is forensic evidence, are important. So these figures right from 2014 conviction rate. So left side charge sheet in rape cases in India, nearly 85 to 90% cases police file charge sheet. But on other side, conviction is limited only to 30 to 35% cases. And this is a grim scenario. Police feels that we have done our job, but court says that, look, your evidence are not sufficient. Not sufficient to convict a person. So this is a dilemma, and this gap has one side 90 to 95%, conviction around 30-35, again the 60% variation. This is matter of concern. Now, this is the result of my research, which is available on internet, and you may find it on ResearchGate as well. Conclusion of my research is that if we conduct DNA coupled with other forensic tools, and particularly recording the statement before the magistrate under section 164 of CRPC, then one may get nearly 95 to 100% conviction rate. So DNA is a very, very powerful tool. And my research has strongly recommended that DNA must be conducted without any doubt or without any fail in all the cases, particularly in body offense like rape, murder, or something where you can collect the DNA sample. So that is the recommendation. This again, this slide actually prove that if you have conducted DNA, then the trial get speedy. You get the speedy trial basically. So it reduces the time for conviction or you can say the completion of trial. So DNA has very important role, not only to prove or disprove guilt, but it speed up the course of court proceedings. So we are actually reaching to the bottom of the truth. That is the purpose of investigation, and DNA certainly helps in this journey. The fairness and other things. One thing I want to add here, that we have talked about fair trial a lot in legal domain, nationally, internationally, in UN covenants and many more. But we hardly talk about fairness in investigation. But my dear friends, let me tell you very clearly that without fairness in investigation, probably we cannot achieve fair trial. That means that until unless we bring correct and good quality of evidence during investigation, trial cannot be fair or effective. So in other words, that fairness in investigation is the precursor to fair trial. I will tell you another facet of Innocence Project, that how right from the beginning in 1984-85, when DNA came into courtroom, at that point of time, the innocence was proved. I will talk about, and this is very important, and I think India and many other countries must observe this Innocence Project, because lot of innocent get convicted for one reason or other. And I think DNA is the key to prove innocence in such matters. This is chain of custody. I think a lot of things might have taught, but chain of custody, whether it is DNA or any other forensic sample, or even during any forensic analysis in the laboratory, this chain of custody is the focal point. If it is broken one way or other, then definitely the defense can challenge that the sample is challenged, it is contaminated, it is fabricated, it is manipulated. So chain of custody is the hallmark, basically, if we want to use forensic science, including DNA. And there are so many, you know, ways and means how these contexts, only the articles or sections may change, but these are the global doctrines of law, like prospective effect, post facto law. You cannot introduce a law post facto from the prospective effect. Then you cannot convict a person twice. That is called double jeopardy and self-incrimination. One point I want to say, that a person cannot be compelled to be the witness against himself or herself. What does it mean? That you cannot compel a person to talk about his criminality. It is a very paradoxical statement. Anybody may say that if a person cannot be compelled to speak about his criminality, then how the truth will come out? This is a question. But law protects, and law gives this right as a fundamental right, because if this right is not there, then police will use third degree and probably they will force a person to confess. So that becomes very, very important, because law says that let hundreds and thousands guilty go unpunished, but not even a single innocent be punished. So with that doctrine in mind, this law is very, very important and significant. I was talking about violence, or you can say third degree. Now the question lies, if it is third degree, there must be first and second degree as well. And what is third degree? Everybody knows it is violence during interrogation or police custody. And it is proscribed everywhere. You cannot touch, you cannot beat, you cannot challenge the body. That means third degree is prohibited. But now the question arises, what is first, second, and third degree? If we just conclude in few sentences, this first, second, third is the numerical value, and degree is quantification of something. Quantification of torture, basically, we are dealing here. And torture is of two types, mental and physical. As I said, physical torture is bodily violence, which is proscribed, which is prohibited under law, whether it is Europe, whether it is India, or any part of the world. So third degree is completely prohibited. Now only thing left is first and second degree, that is mental torture. Now question arises, what is first and second degree? Suppose if you are calling a person at police officer or any law enforcement agency, at police station or any other office, the person get tense, he feel mentally tortured. And till time you are asking general questions about the crime, about his background, till that time it is first degree. But the moment you start confrontation of the facts, then it start second degree. And my dear friends, scientific investigation basically starts with confrontation. Those police officers or investigators who have full spectrum of background note, they are well prepared about the questionnaire to be asked about the subject regarding the crime during interrogation, then only they can reach to the bottom of the truth. And those who avoid that type of preparation, they generally resort to third degree. So those who do not use second degree properly, they generally jump first degree to third degree. So that is very, very important. These are the case laws, basically Kathi Kullu Ogad. All these cases are relevant for different purpose. Kathi Kullu was important for fingerprint. Nandini Satpathi provide right not to speak. That means right to silence. Then Selvi talk about the consent part of forensics. And Ritesh Sinha is very recently, about a year back, in August 2019, it talks about the bias spectroscopy. The Supreme Court of India has empowered the magistrate to order or to direct the subject to give voice sample. So these are very relevant judgments for the purpose of our discussion. One thing I want to tell, because many of you may not be having the legal background, and I sincerely request you, because I was also a scientist, I was having a science background. I never have read law as a student before I started my LLB degree. I was a police officer. I was practicing law, but without having the study of that subject. But I want to flag you one thing only, that if you want to read something, you want to know about the legality, please read the judgments. Say, for example, if you read, want to understand the medical negligence, please write down medical negligence on Google and put one word, Indian Kanun. Indian Kanun is a search engine, and that you will get so many judgments. And if you read judgments, you will find the law, the one side defending the matter, one side putting the allegations, and then honorable judge, whosoever it may be lower court or higher court, they analyze, and based on argumentation, they reach to a conclusion. So that is a live law, and that you understand in a better manner. So these are some aspects on consent on the left side. Consent is very, very important, and there may be adverse possession in case you do not allow somebody. Suppose in case of paternity, suppose a person refused to give blood sample, then under section 114 of Indian Evidence, adverse presumption may be deduced. That means that you may not be giving the sample because you may be guilty. So these are certain perspective and percept of law, and we must be knowing all these things. So these are some more aspect of consent and different issues and challenges about these are the case laws. I can talk lot about all these things, but I think data privacy and other things, data privacy, even the DNA is also a very, very strong source of data. We will talk in the next judgments. And one another case is very important, Maryland versus King. This is 2013 US case, where it permit buccal swab for DNA. No violation of Fourth Amendment of US Constitution. So every case is very important and interesting as well, but because of paucity of time, I am just skipping. Now, as I mentioned, in India, right to privacy has become integral part of right to life under Article 21. So now right to privacy is fundamental right. It can be challenged under Article 32 and 226 of Indian Constitution. My dear friends, please understand that Aadhaar card case, which is the second one, this Puttaswamy are two cases. One was decided in 2017, another in 2018. Both cases have dealt DNA at length. Those who have interest may please go through that. These are voluminous judgments running into 500 pages. I understand you cannot read each and every line, but if you just find out the component where DNA is referred to, please read that, and then you can understand why DNA was not permitted for various reasons. Because apart from matching, to help matching of the unidentified persons, this also carries so many genetic informations. So how to protect misuse of those genetic information remains the focal point of these judgments. A very interesting judgment. And not only that, in Indian scenario, I always say that police also deal with right to privacy in a very grave and great manner. And I think we also need to understand these judgments in that respect. But as forensic scientist sitting here, I would say that you must understand these judgments with reference to how to maintain privacy with respect to the leftover sample. Suppose if you have given some blood sample and you have left it somewhere here and there, and if somebody picked up and misused, say for example, if somebody want to fix a person for rape, if these samples are picked up and inserted into private part of a female and rape allegations are being labeled, then probably a person may be fixed. So these samples have very important sanctity. How to maintain that privacy part is very important, and one must understand thoroughly when we are dealing. Otherwise, as I mentioned, that it is now not only legal right, it is fundamental right. So now it is very rigorous, and if anybody falls into trap, he may face a lot of trouble without any reason. Now, this is another point, reliability and validity. My dear friends, as I mentioned earlier, that DNA is a very established science, but to get validity, or you can say to accept in the scientific domain as forensic evidence, these are the two main criteria. One is the reliability. What you look under reliability, whether the technique can be reproduced or replicate, whether the results are consistent, and they are trustworthy. So this is first area how a technique, scientific technique, enter into forensic domain. Another one is the validity. Validity is the conceptualization or theorization. And DNA has a strong scientific basis for identification. So in my view, and not only my view, it is an accepted phenomena that both on the touchstone of reliability and validity, DNA is accepted worldwide. So there is no question of reliability and validity of the technique per se. But this but is important, that you have to prove that there is no manipulation, there is no other hanky-panky, the technique used were accredited, the man behind or the scientist was properly trained. And then if all these things, so technique per se is accepted, but man behind or other aspect are very important. I will talk about DNA fraud. There we will talk a little bit more on the subject. These are also some aspects, like if you probably must be knowing about the Frye test, Dover test and all. I think it needs some detailed discussion, but time probably may not permit me again, as I am aware about the timeline. So I think by 1:30 I have to finish. So now let me enter into the legal framework. My dear friends, we have two type of law. One is called substantive law, another is called procedural law. Substantive law means it talks about substance. That means, like in Indian Penal Code, it talks about the ingredient of crime and the prescribed punishment. So Indian Penal Code, POXO Act, and many more such act, they are substantive law. On the other side, how to implement, we need some procedures. So other side is the procedural law, like Indian Evidence Act, CRPC, CPC and all. So Indian Evidence Act deals both criminal matter as well as civil matter. So Indian evidence is both way utilized. On other side, CRPC deal exclusively for criminal matter. So that is applied in criminal courts. So section 45 to 51, it deals about the expert opinion. And interestingly, in this section of Evidence Act, there is no word forensic science. They talk about opinion of experts. And expert may be in foreign law, they may be science. So in this second term, science, forensic science laws. So it, forensic science is covered in the second slot. Even in art, on the art subject, there may be an expert. Likewise, handwriting. And interestingly, our Indian Evidence Act was framed in 1872. So now more than 150 years have been passed, nearly 150 years now. So that time, handwriting was kept separate, finger impression. It was not part of science, but now I think it is very much part of forensic science and it is one of the discipline. So these are different other sections, but for our purpose, we are more concerned about section 45. Although section 46 deals with fact based upon opinion of experts and all. So when in 2000, the evidence, this Cyberspace Act was brought. So this electronic evidence came into being. So there are a lot of amendment 45A, 47A, and different opinion and experts' opinion were also mentioned in our Indian Evidence Act. So now let me talk about CRPC. So you please first see the right side, section 291, CRPC. It deals with the medical expert opinion, medical witness. And interestingly, it is not called witness, it is called deponent. So they are free. They are neither for defense nor for accused side, not for prosecution side. So they are basically deponent. So they give the opinion. Now in section 292, that is very, very important. For our purpose, if I say two sections are important, 45 for Indian Evidence Act and 292 for CRPC. It talk about witness, officer of mint, not printing press, security printing press, any forensic department or forensic science laboratory. Here only we get forensic word. Another is state examiner of questioned document. Okay. So these are the list. And under section 293, subsection 4, there is a list. And that list talk about various examiners, and all examiners are not there. My dear friends, even DNA does not exist here. You just see serology is there, then fingerprint is there, explosives are there, chemical examiner. But we covered here the DNA and other background, other forensic science are covered under 293 subsection 4 subclause G. Any other government scientific expert is specified by notification by the government. So DNA is covered by this. But many times if you go to court, people raise, particularly defense raise this question that DNA does not exist in 293 exclusively. So my take here is that now India is actually overhauling the criminal law in entirety, whether it is IPC, CRPC, Evidence Act. I think it is the time where exclusive chapter should be dedicated to forensic science, including all possible sciences which are in existence. So this is, let us talk in 5-10 minutes. The remaining time I will just dedicate to DNA. This is the genetic information, genetic witness. And everybody knows about Alex Jeffrey. I have nothing to talk about. But only thing I want to give one anecdote, probably majority of you must be aware about the two girls, though how the DNA was introduced. Two girls were raped. They were minor girls, about 12, 13, adolescent girls, in 1983 and 1985. The modus operandi of crime was same. They were raped, brutally killed. And they were cold cases, having no clue of the perpetrator. Police of London, they caught one fellow called Richard Buckland. At that time, he was of age 20, 21. He was a little bit mentally challenged. He accepted the second case that I have committed this crime. But somehow or other, the investigating officer of both the cases were same. He was not convinced the fact revealed by Richard Buckland. He was knowing Professor Alex Jeffrey, who was not dealing any way in the crime matter, but he was actually researching regarding connection of DNA or human identification through DNA. He requested, and Professor Jeffrey got this challenge. Nearly 500 samples were collected. When you collect sample of a particular population, it is called DNA dragnet. In that exercise, at one day, when this process was going on for collection of blood sample to conduct DNA, one chap called Peter Pitchfork, he revealed to his friend sitting on a tea stall that I have sent my friend to impersonify me and to give blood sample on my behalf, who successfully did it. This information was passed on to police, and Pitchfork was caught, and ultimately we got this new science, DNA fingerprinting. So at this point, I want to flag that right from its inception, DNA has proved not as a potent tool to link crime with criminal, but also help to prove innocence of Richard Buckland. Had this technique was not there, probably in a routine manner, Buckland would have been behind the bar. And my dear friends, country like US, where this innocence project was invented way back in 1996 by two very prominent advocates. So every year, almost 100-150 cases of innocence have been proved. And in 2018, more than 20 people who were on death row, they were proved innocence. You just see, US has more efficient criminal justice system. They use lot of science, lot of forensics, lot of scientific temper into investigation. Still, they have lot of, you know, proved cases of wrongful conviction. So you consider in Indian context, not only Indian, in Asian context per se. So I think we need such type of tools in our domain as well. Now, let me talk where this DNA word appears in our CRPC. Only in 53A and 164A, these two sections had only footprint of DNA. 53A deals with accused. When you conduct medical examination and the investigator or of the rank of sub-inspector and above has requested you to collect blood sample for DNA, then as medical practitioner, you have to collect DNA sample. On other side, for the victim, medical examination is conducted under section 164A. There, you may collect DNA sample, that is blood, apart from vaginal swab and other things, but with the consent of the victim. In this case, 53A, you need not to have any consent. Whether he refused or not, you can take the sample. But in 164A, in case of victim, to conduct medical examination as well as to collect DNA sample, that is blood or maybe saliva or something, whatever is the new technology, then you need consent. And very important judgment, Lilu alias Rajesh, is a very significant case of Supreme Court on this aspect. These are various important judgments on civil matter. On the left side, yellow color, Gautam Kundu, probably very, very important. 5 guidelines were issued where DNA can be conducted, because when DNA came, I think initially DNA was more used for the determination of paternity. So 5 guidelines were used, given. Then Sarda, then Nandlal Vadbik, and Deepan Vitarai. All judgments are very important judgments. I am a regular writer on forensic law for the Supreme Court in Annual Survey of Indian Law. So I extensively write on these, and those who have interest may go through my articles on ResearchGate. On the right side, there are plethora of judgments. I have just picked up 3-4, like Sushil Sharma case, Naina Sahni, probably you might be remember. And DNA was very important to establish the charred body of the young girl. Then Sunil Kumar Singh, he was the son of an IPS officer. This case, Priyadarshini Mattu case, if you remember, she was the law student and he was having one side love with that girl. She was the classmate and he went there, and the DNA ultimately helped, and very beautiful judgment of the High Court as well as Supreme Court. It was basically in this case, the trial court has extensively discussed about DNA, and because it was in the formative stage, probably judge was not aware of the nuances of DNA. And the quote I do not have here, but it says that I know that Mr. S.K. Singh has done this, but I have no evidence and I am acquitting. So that was the state of affair. And how DNA was established, I think this judgment is a hallmark judgment to understand that how DNA was established. And I must praise none other than Professor Dr. Lalji Singh, who fought day in and day out to establish DNA in courtroom. Fortunately, he was my co-guide in my research from Tata Institute of Social Science. I pay my homage and regard for him, the late soul. Then Dharmendra Dev Yadav, in the beginning itself, DNA has been appreciated by Supreme Court in a very big manner. I think one must read this judgment. And ultimate hallmark is the Mukesh versus State of Delhi, where beautiful, you know, praise have been made in favor of DNA, how potent this DNA is. So I think you are all scientists, probably have these judgments, and then you will find that how the legal fraternity has accepted the evidentiary strength of DNA in courtroom. I think this is the last slide. I am at the concluding side. I know I have almost to the closure side. I have already mentioned about the contamination, loss, degradation, manipulation, tampering, and so many things. But I will just talk about the forensic fraud. And if you see the right side of the last line, the state of NCT Delhi versus Khurshid. This is very, very interesting case of 2018. And I will just give anecdote. The same bench of Honorable High Court Delhi was actually dealing the POXO cases. POXO, the child sexual abuse. And other evidence like medical injury on the private part of the victim, many other circumstantial evidence. They were crying, saying that, look, this is the culprit. The accused is the culprit. But DNA was negative. And that was the reason the lower court, the trial court, made acquittal. And it was not the one case. In consecutive three cases, where appeal were dealt by the High Court, the same scenario. This was the fourth case, Khurshid. Court got doubt. Court sent the samples to laboratory for re-examination, re-conducting the DNA test. And to utter surprise and horror, the DNA was matched. That means it proved that culprit is connected with the crime through DNA. And other three cases were also sent later. It got the same fate. That means there was forensic fraud. And it is same to say that Honorable Court ordered CBI inquiry. At that point of time, I was serving in that organization. And you know the fate. So what I mean to say that science, whether it is DNA or other, cannot speak lie. But man behind can do any wrong, any fault, any fraud. So we have to be very, very cautious and careful while dealing forensic science, because it is matter of life and death. So we should not be any, you know, fancy about any science. We have to be very cautious, and particularly the forensic fraternity, prosecution, as well as the judges. So with this, now I conclude my discussions.